Executive Brief. Executive
Brief. My good people of Abia State, it is my honor and pleasure to address
you. From the seat of governance in Abia, God's own state, comes a compendium of the governor's weekly engagement and the service to humanity and God.
This government is in its second and final tenor, and therefore we are in a hurry to gain traction and achieve what our mandate people have given to us and defined for us as assignment.
Join the Chief Press Secretary to Abia State Governor Onyebuchi Imemanka on Flow 94.9 FM as he tracks Governor Okezie Ikpeazu's activities in delivering on the social contract with the good people of Abia State.
We have received awards and acknowledgement as the SME capital of Nigeria in recent times.
Executive Brief. Every Friday at 9:30 a.m. on Flow 94.9 FM, the flow of God's own state. Executive Brief from the horse's mouth.
There is now a deliberate effort to ensure that our infrastructure is solid and durable.
Well, this is the Executive Brief, and of course, brought to you by the office of the Chief Press Secretary to the Governor of Abia State. During the week, there was a major shakeup in the cabinet. Well, major or minor, depends on how you want to say it. But with some commissioners losing their jobs and some persons getting suspended, you can call that a major shakeup. Virtual meetings of the People's Democratic Party governors and a lot of visitors to the government house, Umaya, which seemed like a beehive of activities during the week under review. This is the Executive Brief, a program that informs you on the weekly activities of the Executive Governor of Abia State, Dr. Okezie Victor Ikpeazu, courtesy of the Office of the Chief Press Secretary to the Governor of Abia State. It's a simulcast on Flow 94.9 FM Umuahia and Real 99.1 FM Aba. My name is Tempo Chinalo Bara, and in the studio is Barrister Onyebuchi Imemanka, the Chief Press Secretary to the Governor of Abia State. Good morning to you.
Good morning, Tempo Bara. It's great to be here again.
All right, let's start off with the suspension of some transition committee chairman, a commissioner of transport getting the boot as well, and two or three commissioner nominees with the press release during the week. Tell us about it. What would have informed the governor on that decision?
Yeah, it must be made very clear that it is a constitutional prerogative of the governor to appoint and choose members of his cabinet. And that prerogative also confers on him the power to review the activities of these appointees and, where possible, apply the sledgehammer.
Okay.
Every governor, every leader of any team embarks on periodic reviews of periodic stock taking of what his appointees are doing. And, you know, if anything goes wrong in this administration, the people will hold the governor responsible.
Yes.
And so when the governor appoints people to assist him perform some of these functions, he expects the highest level of dedication, the highest level of devotion from these people. And where in the wisdom of the governor, some of these people do not live up to the expectations, in their jobs, then necessary actions will be taken. It is important at this point to say that in a state like Abia, with close to 5 million people, and in a party like the People's Democratic Party with close to 2 million members, it is a huge privilege to be called upon to serve.
Okay.
Because whether anybody likes it or not, the position anybody occupies today, there are hundreds of thousands of people out there who are qualified, even more qualified, to hold that position. If you are invited to come and work and serve the government, serve the people of Abia State in any capacity, such appointee must view such invitation as a wonderful privilege.
Okay, let's specify, let's go particular. Let's talk about the commissioner who was sacked, transport.
Yes.
What could have been the reason?
Well, I wouldn't want to go into that. The important thing is that the governor has done a review and saw clear gaps and decided to strike.
The new commissioners, one may replace the former commissioner.
Well, you know, there are currently now there are two vacancies in the State Executive Council.
Okay.
The death of
Commissioner for Environment,
Solomon Ogunji.
Okay.
Who is from Okwa East. Yes. Created a gap, and then the removal of the Commissioner for Transport, who is from Osisiomangwa, also created it.
So the two,
Mr. Tony Nwamo, the commissioner nominee, is from Okwa East. Then Chief Goswill Uchenwanoro, the commissioner, the second commissioner nominee, is from Osisioma. So at all times, the governor does his best to balance this.
The TMAS general manager, the Traffic and Indiscipline Management Agency? A lot of people felt, you know, he's been doing a good job. So what could have gone wrong?
Where the governor sits, the vantage position the governor occupies, he sees things people do not see.
Okay.
There are information available to him. There are things he knows and he sees that others do not see. You see, governance is not a popularity contest. The governor, the TMAS was created by this administration.
Exactly.
And the parameters for performance were set by this administration. So the governor has his own personal expectations. You know, for him to have done that, what it means is that he has noticed gaps, he has noticed issues here and there.
Okay.
And if you check, in the case of the TMAS man, Engineer Bright, Osama, he wasn't sacked, he was suspended. And the suspension could suggest that if things are corrected, there is a possibility of a return. I wouldn't know. That is the discretion.
So who is running TMAS at the moment?
TMAS is an agency of the state government with full complement of workers. The suspended general manager used to be an assistant general manager, a deputy general manager, before he was elevated. So with his elevation, somebody else occupied the position of deputy general manager. So at all times in all government agencies, there's always somebody there to hold the fort.
All right, so let's go to one other story which, you know, made the rounds during the week. Very, very sensitive one. And if I had to borrow your own words in describing the scenario, the governor wields his bit stick again. And that's the case of the Secondary Education Management Board secretary. Well, let me use your words specifically. Moorhead's role as Ipazu approves immediate compulsory retirement of the suspended executive secretary of the Secondary Education Management Board. Prior to this time, there were issues of people being employed without waiver.
Yes.
That trended. And there was a committee set up, you know, to investigate and reported back that over 5,000, am I right?
Yes.
According to the report making the rounds, it's over 5,000 people that came on board and they were employed without waiver. How has this been, you know, left? How did it go unnoticed?
Well, you see, the government is an octopus. It's a huge octopus, you know. A lot of things go on in government. Usually, when there is an embargo on employment, as it is in Abia State today, if the government notices that there are areas that require critical intervention by way of employment, the governor grants waiver. The power to grant waiver is conferred on the governor exclusively. No other person can grant waiver for employment in the civil service of Abia State except the governor.
Okay.
So usually heads of ministries, heads of agencies approach the governor and inform him through official channels that there are critical vacancies that need to be, you know, filled immediately. And after a review, the governor usually grants waiver for a specified number of persons to be employed, you know, to occupy these positions, you know, to fill these vacancies. In the case of the SEMB, the information is that the governor granted waiver for a particular number of persons. I don't know the number again, maybe 100 and something vacancies was what the governor approved. So, how the number rose to over 5,000 is what I cannot explain. And when people are employed, when people think they are employed, when they are issued employment letters and actually start work, they expect to be paid. So after some time, the issues came up and the governor started asking, what happened?
So could that have been as the reason why we do have issues with secondary school teachers' payment of salaries and all?
Well, it's part of it. And what the governor did, this report came up quite some months ago. And what the governor did in his wisdom was to set up a committee to review that whole employment process, you know, and benchmark the number of persons employed against the waiver actually granted by his office. And the committee did the full work and reported back to government and said there was an increase in the number, unjustifiable increase in the number of persons employed, way and above the waiver granted by the governor. So the implication of that is that for all intents and purposes, any person given employment, purportedly given employment beyond the number granted by the governor, was never employed.
Is that why the secretary of SEMB was retired?
Well, that again is the discretion of the governor, and he has exercised it. In his view, that amounted to gross dereliction of duty, and he expects his appointees to stand and follow strictly instructions given from his office, especially when it has to do with issues of employment. You know, we are having issues with wage bill, salaries and all that. So government is usually very careful before they employ people, so that they employ the number of people that the state resources can carry. As much as the governor is desirous, as much as the state government is desirous of providing jobs for teeming number of unemployed youths from Abia State,
okay,
such employment, such move, such desire must be matched by resources to pay them. So, you know, a lot of people have been saying that people were sacked. You know, I want to, you know, associate myself with the Honorable Commissioner of Information, Chief John Okeikalu, who made a post yesterday and say, you cannot sack somebody you never employed.
Okay.
The word sack presupposes that there was an employment. You cannot sack somebody who was never employed. So what it means is that all those people, and very unfortunately, you know, who thought they were employed, were never employed. It's very unfortunate. But government did say in the release made by the chief of staff that since there is now a pool, okay, of purportedly employed people who now know that they were never employed, since there's a pool, whenever government wants to embark on any recruitment drive to fill vacancies in those areas,
yeah,
government does not need again to look too far to find people, since there is a pool now of people who actually has started work. It's very unfortunate. I feel sorry about it, but government work has to go on.
All right, so within the week as well, the governor was part of a PDP virtual meeting, of which certain agreements came to be. After the meeting, it was also published as a form of a press statement made available to the public. Let's take a look at that. The governors deliberated on various issues and encouraged Nigerians to contain the COVID-19 disease. And the meeting resolved to set up two committees of forum, namely the Legislative Liaison Committee. And the members of the committee were Senator Bala Muhammad as chairman, Dr. Ifeanyi Okowa, Honorable Ifeanyi Ogwuanyi, Udom Gabriel Emmanuel, and Senator Duro Diri. We also had the Legal Affairs Committee with its members as well. Forum room did congratulate Jegede San on his emergence as a flag bearer of the PDP in the forthcoming October elections. A whole lot, you know, was resolved and agreed, and that meeting came to a conclusion. Of course, the governor of Abia State, Okezie Victor Ikpeazu, who is also the vice chairman of that committee, was in attendance virtually. But during the week, we noticed visitors from across the other side to Abia State.
Yeah.
Government House seems to have received someone from the Federal Character Commission, a son of the soul in Paul Ikonne, in as much as he has affiliations to the All Progressive Congress. Then a senator representing Imo West, also of the APC. What does this amount to? PDP on the other hand, and visitors from the APC.
You see, we must draw a clear line of demarcation between partisan politics and leadership.
Okay.
Partisan politics is usually very prominent during elections, during campaigns. After elections, after campaigns, partisan politics, to a very large extent, takes the back seat.
Okay.
And leadership, statesmanship, service to the people come to the forefront. So, when citizens of Abia State who get federal appointments come to see the governor will at all times receive them. We are Abians before we belong to political parties. Principal Lee Codney, the Executive Secretary and Chief Executive Officer of the National Agricultural Land Development Authority, is a distinguished son of Abia State, a very senior prince of Ungwaland, a former commissioner in this state, a former general manager of the Abia Transport. He has served the people of Abia State, and by the magnanimity of the President Commander-in-Chief, he was appointed to head a very crucial, very critical, very fundamental federal agency, you know, that manages land resources across the country for purposes of agriculture. And agriculture is one of the pillars, one of the main pillars of the of development as initiated by Governor Okezie Igbazu. So there is no reason whatsoever why the governor would not receive with open arms Principal Ikone, who is of course his brother, and by accident of politics is a member of APC, but he holds a key national position, and it is only commonsensical that he is received with the honor and dignity of his office. And in doing that, the governor made a clear statement to the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria that the government and people of Abia State are grateful for looking the way of Abia State. He could have picked that position. He could have given it to some other person from some
There's been this issue in the past place. That even as the case of the NDDC, that Abia doesn't have, you know, the right or enough representation. Or don't even have any representation.
We do. Every state, every member state of the NDDC has commissioners representing the state.
Okay.
The point is this: a son of Abia State gets a federal appointment, critical federal appointment, and it is only commonsensical. When a man is given an appointment, he appoints his own personal aides to help him work, and you don't go elsewhere. You have to work with people you know. So by the token of that appointment, a lot of people from Abia State are already employed, you know, and as chief executive of a federal agency, he has a great platform to do a lot of things, positive things, give jobs to people, push federal government's attention to agricultural land issues in Abia State. And one of the issues the prince, the executive secretary, raised that day was the issue of the golden chicken farms at Ogwe in Ukwa West. You know, the people of Ukwa West want the federal government to get involved through NALDA. And he made an official request to the state government to make that happen. And the governor assured that once necessary papers get to him, he will look at it, and with all the merits it deserves. These are one of the reasons why we want our people to get into. Now, look, in this, Nigeria is a complex federation.
Okay.
And it is a privilege if somebody from your state gets appointed into such positions.
Let's talk about
a lot of things happen. The same thing is applicable to the Honorable Henry Obulogo, the Federal Character Commission. He is a commissioner. He is the commissioner representing Abia State. The Federal Character Commission, by its enabling law, every state, just like all other commissions, Civil Service Commission, all these other commissions, every state has a commissioner that represents it on the board of these federal commissions. So Honorable Henry Obulogo is from Isukwato. He is an Abian and member representing Abia State in the Federal Character Commission. And the Federal Character Commission, by constitutional provisions, is required to monitor the adherence to federal character in employment, especially. You know, a lot of people complain our people are marginalized in the armed forces, in the police, we are marginalized. It is the job of the Federal Character Commission to monitor this and advise the federal government appropriately. So any Abian who gets the privilege of getting appointed into such critical federal agencies will get the support of the Okezie Igbazu led administration. And that was exactly what happened. The governor made it clear to him. They made a lot of requests, and the governor said yes. And the governor used that opportunity to reiterate and harp on the absence of a federal secretariat in Abia State. It is an absolute misnomer that a state like Abia has no federal secretariat. If you come here, you see federal agencies and offices housed in different privately arranged accommodations. The parents, ordinarily, there should be a federal secretary in every state that will house all federal agencies operating in that state. And the governor was very worried. He expressed deep concern.
But is there land available to that purpose?
For federal secretariat?
Would the federal government require the Abbey State government to provide land resources?
Of course, if they want us, after all, the Federal Character Commission applied for land from the state government and they got it. And the commissioner told the governor yesterday that they had completed their office and moved in. So, but the governor wasn't very happy that federal agencies in the state stay in scattered places. There should be, that is the standard procedure. You know, he used the opportunity to lament on the seeming nonchalance of even all the oil companies. Oil and gas have been drilled in Abia.
But they don't have
mined in Abia since the 1960s. Yet, you will not come anywhere in Abia State and see even a liaison office of any major oil company. And Abia youths, the people who blow up pipelines in the Niger Delta, in the core Niger Delta states, are youths like we have them here. But by the grace of God and by the diplomatic shuttles of Governor Kezi Bazo, there has never been cases of vandalism of oil installations. Our youths, especially in Okwa, East and West, where we have oil, have remained very calm. Yet, these people come here, mine oil, go back to Port Harcourt, pay taxes in Port Harcourt, set up offices in Port Harcourt. Every morning they will drive from Port Harcourt into Abia, do their business, mine oil, take oil and gas and go. You know, these are very unfair. And that governor used the opportunity to make that point very clear.
Sound very
then harsh. Of course the visit of the former governor. Once you are a governor in Nigeria, you are a governor, and you are entitled to certain niceties, certain official niceties. And when the former governor of Imo State and current senator was in Abia State, he came to pay a condolence visit to the family of another APC chieftain, Chief Nyenera Anyim, okay, who is the chairman of one federal commission who lost his father, I think. So he came to the state to commiserate with him. And of course, as a former governor and a brother governor from a neighboring state, we all were in Imo State before. It will not be proper that he will come into Abia State and leave without coming to, you know, visit his friend. And he came and he was well received, given all dignity and honor, you know, befitting a former governor and a serving senator. Whether anybody likes it or not, no matter your views about him, Rochas is an elder statesman in Nigeria. He's a former governor, and he's entitled as of right to be received properly. You know, and he said he personally came to rejoice with the governor. He said that this is the first time he's seen a COVID-19 survivor. So he came to say, join the governor in thanking God for saving his life, you know, from COVID-19. And for the peace that has endured. Let me tell you, look at what is happening across the country. Look at Edo State. Look at some other states. Abia has remained peaceful. And the peace Abia enjoys is a clear reflection of the peaceful disposition of the governor.
Thank you very much, Chief Press Secretary, Barrister Onyebuchi Emenanka. There's a whole lot that happened in the week we'd have wanted to look at, but for want of time, and for the purpose of discretion, we'll let that lie till next week. But I'll let you say something for the next 30 seconds as a way of summarily wrapping up today's conversation.
Governor Kezi Bazo is back, as everybody knows, fully recharged to continue to discharge his...
Will more heads roll?
Well, we watch and see. Okay. I mean, I am not... it is the governor that decides whether heads will roll or not. Abians continue to pray for our governor, continue to remember that COVID-19 remains a potent threat, continue to protect yourself, especially now that our children are preparing to go back to school, especially those in the exit classes. Please continue to protect them. Take steps to protect your children. Buy them face masks, buy them face shield, buy them sanitizers. Do not allow your children... Talk to your children before they go back to school. Let them understand that this disease is real and can kill. Even as they go back to school to write the exit exams, let them continue to observe the essentials of social distancing. Let them remember. And let us as parents show examples. Thank you very much. And God will protect our people.
Definitely. It's been the Executive Brief. a simulcast on Flow 94.9 FM Umwahia, Real 99.1 FM Aba, and of course on the official Facebook account of the Chief Press Secretary to the Governor, Barrister Onyebuchi Emenka. Until we come your way next week, we'll continue to monitor the activities of the Governor and bring it to you in the form of a compendium so you can follow up. My name is Temple Bara. Bye for now.
At Flow 94.9 FM, we've got conducive and well-secured environment for business. High-tech video studio, a state-of-the-art production studio. You can also listen live on www.flow949fm.com and watch our videos on YouTube at Flow FM TV. Flow 94.9 FM, not just radio, but a complete broadcasting house.